But it was not the front of the ship that shot forward, as William Cave saw it. The bow had already shattered into a million pieces. Instead, Cave must have witnessed the stern shooting forward, travelling past the wreckage of the bow. By then, most of the men he imagined suffering on board, the stuff of his nightmares, would already have been dead. Even Beatty, with his bravado, was shocked by this second unexpected loss. "There is something wrong with our bloody ships today," he was heard to declare. In fact, there was nothing wrong with the ships. The fault lay in commanders demanding speed over safety.
There's a history in the Navy where rate of fire against your enemy is what wins you a fight. If you can fire faster than the chap is firing at you, you will take him out. So everybody working in the gun turret, their prime motive is to make sure that the guns are being loaded and fired as fast as they possibly can. And it has been suggested, not only in the battlecruiser fleet, but also in the main fleet itself, that a lot of the safety features, the flash doors and the rest, were left open. But of course, if you do this, you potential for the ship to be nothing more than a tinderbox.
With the safety doors left open and ammunition and explosives stacked around the turret and magazine, the turret shaft becomes like a fuse with a huge bomb below. One strike. And the whole ship goes up. Beatty would later be accused of being too gung-ho. In the first phase of the battle, he had pursued the Germans without waiting for backup. He had also allowed safety procedures to be relaxed on ships under his command to achieve a faster rate of fire.
I can't help feeling that there was an element of recklessness in the man, you know. He loved riding to the hounds. He obviously liked the thrill of the chase, and that's all fine and good. The criticism levelled at Beatty at the beginning of the Battle of Jutland is that perhaps the thrill of the chase slightly got the better of the man.
With his own ship battered and two of his battlecruisers sunk after just an hour of combat, Beatty was in for another shock. Now he learned he was facing not just Hipper's scouting party, but the entire German high sea fleet. He led his ships in a U-turn, trying to entice the Germans towards the far bigger British Grand Fleet. However, he failed to communicate effectively with Jellicoe.
I don't think he was very good professionally. For example, when he's running back towards the Grand Fleet, pursued by the German fleet, Jellicoe signals him and says, "What is the course of the German fleet?" He's got to know where they're going so that he can make up his own disposition. This is a critical thing. Instead, what Jellicoe gets back is, "They're right there, they're on my tail."
For Jellicoe, time was now critical.
I thought
ambush in British history, and make an even bigger name for himself than Nelson. The immediate outcome of the First World War was in his hands. Early on the evening of the 31st of May, 1916, Admiral John Jellicoe, commander of the British fleet, lay in wait as his Vice Admiral David Beatty attempted to lure the German fleet into his path. Under the command of Reinhard Scheer, the smaller and less well-armed enemy were now heading into a trap.
The Germans are now facing a horizon full of enemy ships. Oh dear.
Jellicoe had very little information or time to act. He deployed his fleet against Scheer in a classic naval tactic, crossing the T.
So you want a situation in which a lot of your guns focus on him and not too many of his focus at you. If you're going along and someone else is across you, then he's in the ideal position. That's crossing the T.
Jellicoe positioned his ships brilliantly, but poor visibility prevented him from delivering the killer blow. Scheer realized the trap. Extraordinarily, he ordered every ship to about turn at the same time and sailed off.
This better turn was something which, of course, surprised Jellicoe, and which eventually saved the German battle fleet. And though Scheer could never explain later why he had acted the way he had done, it was ingenious.
Later, to cover his escape, Scheer ordered his destroyers to launch a mass torpedo attack. Jellicoe faced another critical decision. To pursue Scheer, he'd have to steam into the oncoming torpedoes. To minimize losses, he'd need to turn away. He chose the safer course.
A lot of the criticism of Jellicoe turning away comes from an early...
Jellicoe's defensive maneuver succeeded. Not one of the 31 German torpedoes hit home. The price was that the German high sea fleet was able to escape under the cover of night.
So by the following morning, the high sea fleet was well on its way and couldn't be caught. It had got away. The one opportunity to sink the high sea fleet had been let slip.
British woes were not over. During the night, HMS Black Prince became separated from the British fleet. Sometime after midnight, her crew spotted what they thought were Jellicoe's ships and fell into line. By the time they realized their mistake, it was too late. They had stumbled into the heart of a German battle formation.
And almost at the same instant came the word. British, salvo, fire! An immense column of fire blazed up, and a devastating fire now opened up on the whole of the enemy ship. She failed to put up any effective defense. So quickly was she overwhelmed. And then the vessel sank, almost in silence.
857 men went down on Black Prince. There were no survivors.
From this absolute nightmare.
The images reveal that the crew realized their mistake. In a desperate bid to escape, they managed to turn the ship around. Too late. Appalling loss of life wasn't confined to the British fleet. Hipper's flagship, the Lützow, was repeatedly battered and bombarded by British forces during the course of the day. If the Queen Mary was Britain's greatest naval loss of the First World War, the Lützow was Germany's.
This multi-beam shows the full length of the ship upside down, and the ship had taken in so much water because it had been hit 24 times by British shells. And when you compare that to the losses of our battle